Good morning. Welcome into the Cam Rogers Show. It is Monday, June 4th, 2018. I am Cam Rogers. We thank you for coming along for the ride on this program. I've got you covered for the next hour. Hit me up on Twitter at Mr. Rogers 99. Let me know what you think about the show. It's a fun one today. I've got game two highlights, Warriors, Cavs from the NBA Finals last night, plus my game two takeaways as we look ahead to game three in Cleveland. Plus, the latest NBA rumors. I'll get you guys set, get your week started right with the latest buzz across the association. And then some NFL headlines to get to. We've got some interesting storylines to watch out for as mandatory minicamp gets going this month. And then my NFL coaching hot seat rankings. Who's in trouble as we enter the 2018 regular season? All that and so much more. Of course, the final word, a little funny video that I'll show you guys at the end of the program. Be sure to hit me up in the comments section as I go through all of these discussion points. And with that, Lena Bond, take me to Oakland. Warriors, Cavs, game two. First quarter we go. Kevin Durant with possession goes right to the rack for two. Then it's Steph Curry, skips past Kevin Love, goes right to the hoop for two as well to put the Warriors up 8-4. Then it's LeBron under the hoop, eventually kicks it out for an open J.R. Smith. That goes for three. Cavs down 17-21. Second quarter now, Draymond for three. Doesn't go. Sean Livingston rips the board out to Kevin Durant for three. He converts it there. Then it's Curry to Durant. Durant dishes it to JaVale McGee, who slams it through for two. Cavs in transition now. LeBron inside and the take for a deuce, it goes. Cavs down by seven. Third quarter now, Cavs down by nine. Good ball movement here for Cleveland. Eventually, it's Kevin Love for three. He splashes it through. Then Kevin Durant atop the key, and he says no problem at all. Beautiful shot there for three. Klay Thompson in transition now, pull up three. One of my favorite shots in all of basketball. Fourth quarter we go. Steph Curry from the corner. Beautiful pump fake, sends the three. It is good. Crowd loves it. Then Curry again, this time driving to the hoop left-handed. Doesn't go. Draymond is there. That goes for two. 187 Warriors lead. James going to work atop the key. He'll go right inside, send it through. Warriors now lead 11. This is the exclamation point here. Curry with possession, the shot clock winding down. He just tosses it up there, and he sends it through for three. That was essentially the summary of the game for the Warriors and the Cavs, respectively. LeBron walks off the court with a loss, 122-103. Your final score in game two of the 2018 NBA Finals. LeBron with 29, 9 rebounds, 13 assists. Couldn't get that one last rebound there. Steph Curry, though, a historic night, 33 points, 7 rebounds, 8 assists. I'll talk about Curry in a matter of moments and what he accomplished last night. But is it all over already? Game two in the books. We're going to Cleveland for game three. Can the Cavs still win the finals? Give me a heart for yes, they can. Give me a like for no, it is over. And for those of you who are saying it is over, can we just point to down one game to three? All right, so that's all I'm going to say there. All right, so we're going along here with the 2018 NBA Finals. Of course, this is not the 2016 version. But still, keep in mind, hit me up in the reaction poll. Give me a heart for the Cavs are still in it. Give me a like for it's all but done. You guys are watching the Cam Rogers Show. I am Cam Rogers. Hit me up on Twitter at Mr. Rogers 99. Let's take a look at my game two takeaways. And we'll start things off with Steph Curry. And the night that he had, he drained an NBA Finals record 9 three-pointers, scored 16 of his game-high 33 points, and made 5 of his 9 three-pointers in the fourth quarter alone to put away the Cleveland Cavaliers. You know what that tells me, guys? First of all, it tells me ability, which we already knew. But we're talking about killer instinct now. Steph Curry with the dagger in his mind, smelling blood in the water like a great white shark with some raw meat in the ocean. That's what Steph Curry had last night. Absolutely balled out. He's averaging 31 points, 8.5 assists, 6.5 rebounds in the first two games of the 2018 NBA Finals. These numbers are a strong jump, you may recall, from past finals that Curry has been in when Kevin Durant and Andre Iguodala have won the finals MVPs and Steph Curry has not. So as of right now, and I don't think this is going to change, the Golden State Warriors are going to win the finals and Steph Curry will be the NBA Finals MVP. And last night was a microcosm of the performance that he has had really in the entire postseason. Of course, had to deal with a few injuries here and there, but he's really catching his own now and it's the perfect time to do that. Curry has scored or assisted on points or on more points in transition than the Cavaliers have scored as a team. So we're talking about 35 to the Cavaliers, 33 in the first two games there. So Steph Curry, absolutely exceptional play so far. You just got to sit back and enjoy what you are seeing. And I have that same mentality with this guy. LeBron James of the Cleveland Cavaliers continues his exceptional play. And this Cavs team has been the LeBron James show for the entire postseason. And the fact that this team is in the finals is unreal in of itself. It's perhaps an indictment on the play of the Eastern Conference this year. The fact that the 76ers went down to the Celtics is kind of amazing to me, and the fact that the Celtics made it as far as they did, also somewhat surprising. And perhaps you could make the argument that the Eastern Conference is a little watered down. But let's put all that aside. LeBron James is coming off a 51-point performance there in Game 2. Last night might have been viewed as a disappointment. But that's the point. The fact that we view last night as perhaps a disappointment is symbolic of what LeBron James has been doing year in and year out, not just in the NBA postseason in general, but in these NBA finals. Now, this finals could be over, but you're not going to see this guy stop competing. He is the ultimate fighter, the ultimate competitor in this league. So if you need an ounce of intrigue to keep watching this NBA Finals, let's say you're not a Cavs fan, you're not a Warriors fan, it's LeBron putting on a display of greatness, game in and game out. Maybe even the best player to ever touch a basketball after it's all said and done. So that's how I view it. I have no rooting interest in this NBA Finals. I'm not from Cleveland, not from Oakland, not from California, not from Ohio, not even close. So I am just from a general sports fan perspective, sitting back and enjoying what is on display from LeBron James and the exceptional play. And that's all I'm really just enjoying here in terms of the Cavalier side of things, because outside of LeBron James has not been all that pretty, more specifically with Jordan Clarkson of the Cavaliers, and he has been getting, shall we say, roasted on Twitter of late. Nick Wright saying, quote, "I like Ty Lue, and I think he's an underrated coach, but his insistence on playing Clarkson is just indefensible. He's simply horrible." Michael Lee of Yahoo Sports said, "Jordan Clarkson might be the only guy in the league who doesn't care that he shares the floor with LeBron James. In the playoffs, Clarkson is just logging 4.9 points per game, shooting 30.3% from the field and 23.9% from downtown, all in 15.4 minutes per game." The guy had 2 points last night. Whew. Yeah, Jordan Clarkson's not really panning out here for the Cleveland Cavaliers at this point in time. And not great timing either when J.R. Smith is getting MVP chants from the Golden State Warriors faithful and you're looking for some sort of cohesion with this Cleveland Cavaliers team and just not getting it right now. It's been the LeBron James spotlight for this entire postseason and it's going to have to continue to be that way as we go throughout Game 3 and Game 4, Game 5 if necessary. But if the Cleveland Cavaliers can't win a game when LeBron drops 51, what is the standard? Are we talking 60 points per game from James? Or is Kevin Love going to step up? You know, Hill, will he step up? Clarkson may have to absolutely turn around his postseason for the Cavaliers to actually have a chance in the rest of this finals here. So Cavs are down 0-2. They're going to Cleveland for Game 3. We'll see if they can turn things around. Those are the takeaways from Game 2. You're watching the Cam Rogers Show presented by AutoList. Are you looking for a new or used car out there? Are you tired of browsing a million sites? Save yourself the time. Head on AutoList.com. Get that car shopping done in a flash or download their fantastic app for iPhone and Android users today. All right, let's get to the latest NBA rumors now, because a lot of you guys are basically in the offseason, if you will. So Jason Kidd recently interviewed for the Pistons head coaching position over the weekend. According to Jordan Schultz of Yahoo Sports, Kidd spent the last 3 seasons as the head coach of the Milwaukee Bucks. He was fired 45 games into the 2017-2018 campaign after a 23-22 start. Not very good, and the Pistons continued their search after Stan Van Gundy was fired last May. And in terms of Van Gundy's resume, the last 4 seasons, the Pistons went 152-176. With 1 playoff appearance. They finished with a brutal 39-43 record in this past season. So Kidd, 45 years old, has 5 years worth of coaching experience with the Brooklyn Nets and the Bucks, of course. He is 183-190 in his career coaching total with 3 playoff appearances. So 2 more than the Pistons under Van Gundy here. So his only playoff series win did come in 2013-2014, his lone season with the Brooklyn Nets. And it was also reported that the University of Michigan head coach Beilein was interviewed, as well as Toronto Raptors head coach Dwayne Casey. So they're under consideration as well. Who should the Pistons hire as their next head coach? Hit me up in comments on Facebook Live as well as YouTube. They've got some talented pieces on that team. Andre Drummond, Stanley Johnson, I like them a lot. Veteran Blake Griffin is there as well. So there are some enticing players there that could perhaps lead to a big brand name kind of hire for the Detroit Pistons. And they're going through their due diligence right now. We'll see who eventually becomes the new head coach. All right, next on the list, do the Houston Rockets want Paul George? So sources have told Rockets Wire, which is the Houston Rockets affiliate from USA Today, that GM Daryl Morey is strongly considering making a run at George. That, and along with perhaps joining the LeBron James sweepstakes once that becomes a thing. And now some salary cap magic would have to happen for the Rockets to land either George or James. And a max contract for James or George would likely come with a first-year salary of around $35 million. Houston currently is slated to have $85.1 million on the books for next season, with the salary cap projected around $101 million. That's also before incorporating Chris Paul's $35.5 million cap hold, which counts against them until he either signs a new contract with the team or he goes elsewhere. So here is the best route, really, with the Houston Rockets in terms of going about either landing George or landing James. It's not going to be via free agency. It's going to be via trade. That just makes more sense to me. So that means George opts in for the Thunder and then tries to facilitate a trade. Same logic with LeBron. He opts in with the Cleveland Cavaliers, tries to facilitate a trade. Well, the Lakers, as you see on your reaction poll here, have the luxury of just shelling out a max contract and be like, hey, Paul, come on over to LA. Because Magic Johnson really wants him. He's been vocal about that. And obviously, in terms of a financial perspective, it's a lot easier for the Lakers to land George than, say, the Houston Rockets. The Rockets have to get creative and perhaps have to go via a trade path rather than what the Lakers would get to do. Max contract, here you go. Paul, come on over to the Lakers. So it depends really on what George wants to do and how much grunt work he wants to put into it. Into all this. Does he want to opt in and facilitate a trade and go through that entire process like a Chris Paul did? Or does he want to just go out west, cash out, maybe he sees another big time ticket item player join the Lakers, or maybe it could be Kawhi in 2019, and maybe Paul George is assured that that will happen the following season. A lot of things are kind of going through the mix here right now, and I think Paul George, outside of LeBron, one of the more interesting storylines as we enter this free agency period here in the NBA. All right, how about some Brian Colangelo follow-up news? Of course, the investigation is ongoing with the 76ers. According to the USA Today, Brian Colangelo's wife, Barbara, could be behind the tweets from the burner accounts allegedly used by Colangelo. So the USA Today wrote the following, quote, a phone number linked to the Twitter accounts ends with the same two numbers as a phone number associated with Barbara. So according to reports, the investigation against Colangelo is growing to the point where the 76ers may just sever ties with him. And even if Barbara is found guilty of going through all of this and setting out the tweets, that actually does not exonerate Brian Colangelo from all of this, according to reports out there and some well-named insiders that are saying this. So certainly a fluid situation, and we could have a resolution to all of this by the end of the week, where we could see Brian Colangelo unemployed, no longer the GM of the 76ers, so stay tuned on that. How about a Jimmer comeback to the NBA? He wants to join. So former NBA guard, of course, said on Friday that he will play in this year's the basketball tournament to perhaps stir up some NBA interest. And he said, quote, I would always love to get another chance in the NBA. I've gotten better in China and improved every year. They hope somebody takes notice. And of course, he has played the last two seasons for the Chinese Basketball Association's Shanghai Sharks. Believe it or not, Jimmer's 29 years old now. Now, he's averaged 37.6 points per game for the Sharks back in the 2016-2017 season when he was named the CBA International MVP, and then averaged 36.9 points this past season. So he's got a good resume, but he's also playing in China, so that's a little relative to all of this here. But he is looking for a comeback in the NBA. We'll see how he does in the basketball tournament, if that can kind of help his stock there to perhaps join a team. All right, let's go to some Lakers-ish notes here. So the Lakers don't want LiAngelo, at least that is the reports out there. The Lakers brought in Ball for a workout recently, but according to USA Today, the Lakers aren't interested in signing him at any level. So we're talking about not just the NBA, but the G League and the like. So in the Lithuanian Basketball League, LiAngelo was averaging 12.4 points per game in 21.7 minutes. I will note, LaVar Ball said back in February that Lonzo Ball would leave the Lakers if LiAngelo and LaMelo were not signed. But let's keep in mind that LaVar Ball says a lot of things, so we will take that with a grain of salt. We're talking about a guy who got into a Twitter beef with the 45th president of the United States. So anything can happen, anything can be said, and maybe this is just a little bit of a smokescreen here. Like I said, this was back in February, so things can change, minds can change, and the like. So for now, LiAngelo Ball, not looking good for the NBA draft. But this guy, he's going to be a high draft pick, Mo Bamba out of Texas. So sources are telling the Sporting News that the Celtics are reportedly interested in drafting Mo Bamba. Now, I will say a lot of Celtics insiders out there have been debunking this rumor. So this is, you know, firmly in the leave it up to you guys to decipher discussion. The Celtics have the number 27 pick, but they do have a good amount of assets to move up if they want to. The Grizzlies at number 4 and the Mavericks at number 5 have made it clear they're willing to make a deal and move back. With Kyrie and Gordon Hayward coming back for the Celtics, you could make the argument, that the role for someone like a Terry Rozier or a Jaylen Brown reduces. I don't see them doing away with Jason Tatum. I think that'd be ridiculous after the postseason that he had. Dallas and Memphis already have point guards in Dennis Smith Jr. and Mike Conley, respectively, so they would almost certainly prefer Brown over Rozier, you would think. So keep that in mind. One of the premier draft rumors here, as we are in the month of June and the NBA draft is not too far down the road, Mo Bamba could be going to the Celtics. We shall see. So that's the rundown with the latest NBA rumors here on the Cam Rogers Show. Hit me up on Twitter at MrRogers99. I am indeed Cam Rogers. We are presented by AutoList. Are you looking for a new or used car out there? Tired of browsing a million sites? Go to AutoList.com to browse the largest source of inventory on the web, or download their top-rated mobile app for Android and iPhone users today. Cam Rogers with you. We've got some NFL headlines to get through, and we'll start things off with the curious case of Michael Kendricks, who I believe has signed with the Cleveland Browns. It's a one-year deal, $3.5 million with Cleveland, joining a pretty solid linebacking core. They got Sherbert there and a couple of other young players that I think Michael Kendricks will really relish as a leadership kind of role here, but this whole thing was not as clear as originally thought. So Ian Rappaport originally reported that Kendricks signed with the Browns, and then things got kind of awkward. So Kendricks clapped back on Twitter. We'll show you a tweet from a St. Pioneer press writer who was on the phone with Kendricks. Here's what he said. So free agent linebacker Michael Kendricks, quote, "No, it's not accurate signing with the Browns. That's all I have to say. I'm not really talking about it." And then Michael Kendricks went into Ian Rappaport's replies and said this: "You will never have my respect." And Michael Kendricks, by the way, is not a frequent tweeter. You go on his timeline, he's not exactly a day-to-day kind of guy on social media. So to see this kind of stuff is pretty interesting. For some reason, this whole story struck a chord with Michael Kendricks. And from a player perspective here, I understand where he's coming from. I think sometimes players want to break the news themselves, or they want the team itself to break the news, and they feel like they are getting undercut, if you will, by these NFL insiders here because, well, they're breaking the news and Michael Kendricks can't do it first. I think that's where the frustration is coming from. So Kendricks was formerly a free agent after the Philadelphia Eagles cut him following a really good 2017 season. Also visited the Raiders and the Vikings last week. It would have been an interesting story, by the way, if he joined the Vikings, because Eric Kendricks, his brother, is there. But this brings up a philosophical question for you guys, because the way in which we gather news sometimes can be unreliable. How do you get your NFL news out there? Mobile, desktop, newspaper, perhaps somewhere else? Of course, right here on the Cam Rogers Show, we hope. But let me know, because this just got me thinking, this whole story here. And just to reiterate, he is signing with the Cleveland Browns. It is a one-year deal. It is $3.5 million with incentives. But the story went, Ian Rappaport tweets, then the St. Pioneer press writer calling Kendricks and Kendricks denying it, Kendricks replying to Ian Rappaport, "You have lost all of my respect." And then Jordan Schultz of Yahoo Sports tweeted out some monetary amounts in terms of the deal. The St. Pioneer press reporter confirmed it, and here we are. So it sounds certainly like Kendricks is signing with the Cleveland Browns, but it just got me thinking about like how we live in this new media age, if you will, of immediacy, and perhaps some earlier reporting than really it should be. Perhaps some people should kind of take their time and check their boxes and then report something. We've seen that multiple times in politics and so many different areas of reporting. So let me know how you guys get your news. Curious. All right, let's go to the next headline on the list here. Rob Gronkowski is returning for mandatory minicamp, which is sad from a media perspective because I really do want to talk about how the Patriots are crumbling before us. But I can't say that about Rob Gronkowski because he has confirmed to be a full go and that he is indeed looking forward to it. Mandatory minicamp begins this week. It consists of 3 days, and there's been some buzz about the Patriots tweaking Gronkowski's contract for the 2018 season. They added around $5.5 million in incentives to his deal last year. The idea is something similar could happen this season, and if you look at his base salary for 2018, it is not indicative of his play and his ability, $8 million. So there you go. Gronk is back. Tom Brady is expected to be back as well for mandatory minicamp. So Patriots fans, guess you have nothing to worry about. The dynasty perhaps is not eroding like we once thought. But I'll believe it when I see it, when Tom Brady is on that football field for mandatory minicamp. I do believe Gronkowski because he has been in conversations with Bill Belichick and basically saying that he will be ready to go for 2018. So there you go. Let's take a look at a former wide receiver here. If anybody out there is hoping for a Calvin Johnson comeback, it ain't happening because Johnson confirmed to the Detroit Free Press that the multiple ankle injuries he suffered as a player simply don't allow him to play at a high level anymore. Here's what he recently said. Quote, and this is unbelievable, by the way. I get up from bed sometimes in the morning. I shuffle across the ground because I can't bend my ankles. So he's getting up in the morning and he's struggling to walk to the bathroom, for crying out loud, to brush his teeth. So for anybody out there thinking, hey, maybe he can make an NFL comeback, I don't really think anybody actually was. He was more of a story, Calvin was, last offseason when teams did show some interest for him. But if you can't extend your ankles or move them around, or you have no mobility, you're running flat-footed, essentially. So Calvin Johnson, comeback ain't happening. Maybe he heads into the broadcast booth, the coaching sphere, certainly not on the football field as an active NFL player. So Megatron, it's all but over. You can put the nail in the coffin there if anybody actually thought he could make a comeback. All right, tough story here for Clay Matthews. It could have been worse. He broke his nose in a charity softball game and was pitching when the incident occurred. He will have surgery on it when the swelling subsides. He did confirm this on Twitter. It was a line drive right to the face. He ran off the field and then quickly went to the emergency room, which, of course, all things considered, good news, just a broken nose, and he sounds to be in good spirits as well. So it could have been concussion related or maybe even getting hit in the eye or something like that. So all of that aside there, not the case. Clay Matthews should be fine. It's just a broken nose, and I say just a broken nose. Obviously, I'm sure it's very painful and he has to go through surgery, but nothing long-term or anything like that. So Packers fans, rest at ease. All right, let's take a look at Patrick Mahomes here. How about this? He is not accepting endorsements until he proves it on the football field. His agent confirmed this, Lee Steinberg. Last year was for obvious reasons. Why have the guy on billboards and commercials when he wasn't even the starting quarterback, Alex Smith was? But this season, for him, it's all about proving his worth. And I love this decision. I think it's a very mature one at that. Because, number one, well, yeah, of course it's mature. I just think you're not portraying yourself as some cocky kind of quarterback that you think you're good and you haven't even proven yourself on the football field. But number two, it's a strategic decision from Mahomes because it doesn't add unneeded pressure on him to perform at the quarterback position. He already has enough pressure. Why go out and advertise for companies and commercials and billboards and magazines and give yourself more pressure to perform as the Kansas City Chiefs starting quarterback when you could just not do all of that, go onto the football field, win games, okay, you've proven yourself, now let's cash out and let's see what happens with the Kansas City Chiefs in the AFC West. I think it's a great move from a couple of fronts. So Mahomes is well equipped this year to have success. There's no doubt about that. He's got Travis Kelce at tight end. Top three tight end in my eyes. Kareem Hunt at running back. Coming off a pretty good rookie year. Tyreek Hill. He's electric on the outside. Then you've got Sammy Watkins, the new acquisition there. So which team will win the AFC West? That's a big-time question for me because I think it could be any of these teams. Chiefs, Chargers, Broncos, and the Oakland Raiders. Give me a like, laughing face, heart, and wow face, respectively. Be sure to let me know in the comments section behind your reasoning as to why you chose that respective team there. I will say right now. I think there's a possibility of actually getting two teams out of this division to make the playoffs. Chargers and Raiders. I have my wariness about the Kansas City Chiefs right now, particularly with that offensive line and the front seven. I know they've addressed that a little bit, but the front seven was not very good last year, especially in stopping the run. And so they're going to have to figure out a way to control the line of scrimmage on that side of the ball. But I have no concerns at all about the offensive side. So we'll see what happens. I think the Chargers, on paper, should win the AFC West. Whether or not they will remains to be seen. All right, let's get to the next headline here. Big story about Aaron Rodgers in that he may want an out clause in the next contract that he signs. So here is the story. According to Mike Garofalo, Rodgers wants some sort of out clause that would allow him to renegotiate the deal if slash when, really when, it's leapfrogged by other quarterbacks when they sign new contracts. So under Rodgers' current deal, dating back to 2013, the following quarterbacks have surpassed him in salary. Ready for these names? Andrew Luck, who we didn't see in 2017 at all. Derek Carr, who dropped off in 2017, although I expect him to bounce back. Matthew Stafford. Jimmy Garoppolo, who has 7 games worth of sample size as a starter. Kirk Cousins and Matt Ryan, all of which are inferior to Aaron Rodgers. And you could really say that about any quarterback in the NFL not named Tom Brady. So whatever Rodgers gets on his contract extension really does not matter in his eyes. This is the logic here, because he knows someone will jump him in the money department. So as such, Rodgers wants the ability to renegotiate, to revisit the contract on the fly. And after all, he is at least the second best quarterback in the National Football League, if not the best. And he deserves to be paid as such. We do go through all of these storylines here with contracts in that they don't necessarily portray the ability of the player. We're talking about, for example, an $84 million fully guaranteed contract for Kirk Cousins. Do you think Kirk Cousins, in all reality, folks, is worth $84 million guaranteed? So from the team perspective now, what the Packers can do is just ignore what Aaron Rodgers wants, and they can just franchise tag him a couple times and be done with it. Now, of course, that runs the risk of creating some sort of division between the Rodgers camp and the Green Bay Packers front office in what could become a Kirk Cousins type of situation, where Kirk Cousins, let's be honest, did not want to be in D.C. after getting back-to-back franchise tags. If Aaron Rodgers doesn't get what he wants, I mean, can you imagine how much angrier he will be compared to Kirk Cousins? Because Kirk Cousins is not the caliber quarterback that Aaron Rodgers is. So if Aaron Rodgers is even better, he might be even angrier if he doesn't get what he wants. And I actually think this is one of the top storylines to monitor this offseason, Aaron Rodgers' contract extension and what is actually written inside it. Does he get that clause? Does he get that ability to renegotiate things as other quarterbacks out there jump over him? So keep that in mind. Aaron Rodgers has his demands, at least according to NFL Network. Odell Beckham Jr., we know his demands. He wants at least $20 million per year, or at least around that number, which is certainly a tall task. So the good news for Giants fans is that Odell is close to being fully cleared to practice. The bad news is that Odell may withhold from fully practicing until he gets that extension that he wants. So it's kind of a bittersweet moment for the Big Blue faithful. So SNY is reporting a possible contract showdown between the Giants and Odell. So there's no new word about progress from the negotiation standpoint between the Beckham camp and the New York Giants. As I mentioned, Beckham wants around $20 million per year, which is a big time ask if you ask me. Ian Rappaport, you may recall, reported back in March that OBJ won't set foot on a football field until he gets that extension. And that report actually hasn't truly been tested yet, because Odell has yet to be fully cleared to practice. Yes, he's been going through drills, and yes, he's been present at voluntary OTAs, but that means nothing, of course, until he's actually fully cleared to go. And here's what I'll say. I think Odell Beckham Jr. has every right in the world to stay out until he gets what he wants. And the Giants, on the other side of things, have every right to kind of just kick the can down the road, because they don't have to address this until next offseason, because Odell is playing on the final year of his rookie contract in 2018. So what we're staring at here is a big fat game of chicken, where eventually someone is going to budge here. And my inkling is Odell will probably play the final year of his rookie contract on that $8.5 million salary, and things will perhaps get settled next year. The question is, does Dave Gettleman, the GM, and the Giants leadership want to run that risk of trotting out Odell on the football field in week one of the regular season, if he even shows up, and on an $8.5 million salary, which is way underpaid, I agree. It's certainly not even close to the target amount that Odell actually wants. So, like I said, game of chicken, something to keep in mind. And if the Giants, I will say this, do not extend Odell and Odell plays throughout the regular season, the bridge could already be burned for 2019, where we could see Odell just say, you know what, you guys messed up with me. And maybe Eli Manning is done, by the way, too, who knows. And he says, I'm going to go to someone who appreciates me. So it's Odell, it's Le'Veon Bell, kind of in that same scenario there, where Bell got the franchise tag, which is obviously not the same as Odell because he's on a rookie contract, but Le'Veon wants to get paid a lot of money too. So there you go. Does Odell deserve $20 million a year? Let me know in comments as we are on Facebook Live and YouTube. Hit me up. All right, let's go to the next story here. And we're talking about the national anthem and the Falcons national anthem strategy. So this is important, and I'm talking about this because every team is going to have to go through this discussion. The Falcons are the first to actually give us some sort of hint here. So, full stop, here are the options in terms of this new national anthem policy. You're on the football field, you stand. You're on the football field, and you kneel and face fines from the NFL. Or you stay in the locker room. Those are your three options in a sense. Two of them come with no punishment, staying in the locker room and standing for the anthem. The Falcons have said, and Matt Ryan specifically, that they will get to this discussion about a strategy in terms of going about the national anthem, and they feel that the best course of action is doing it in unison. So the entire team staying in the locker room, the entire team standing, or the entire team kneeling, which I think is the least likely scenario. I think the most likely scenario is the entire Falcons organization stands on the football field. But I think this could perhaps be a good blueprint for other teams out there, in that these NFL teams are going to have to sit down and be like, all right, guys, how do you want to do this? And if all the teams out there decide that they will go through their decision in unison, that probably combats any potential distractions out there and combats overall hurting team chemistry, right? I mean, think about it. For example, Kenny Stills has not ruled out kneeling during the national anthem this year on the football field. Let's say you have 5 to 8 Miami Dolphins players kneeling on the football field. You have like 15 to 20 in the locker room, and then you have the rest of the team standing. What does that show in terms of team chemistry, team cohesion? Probably not very good. From a PR standpoint, it doesn't look good. Stephen Ross probably wouldn't be a fan of it, I don't think, because he was the guy that felt the pressure from the president to put forth this policy. And how do you think it works in the locker room, too? Because some players who are standing are like, guys, we're getting railed by the media. We're getting railed by perhaps our owner. What's going on here? Why can't we all just decide on one decision? So I bring up this story because I think it's important from an NFL general perspective. The Falcons are going through this, but every single team will have to go through this and have a discussion in terms of the best course of action. Be sure to let me know what you think that best course of action is. Everybody standing, everybody kneeling, everybody staying in the locker room, or hey, just let them do what they want. So be sure to let me know in comments. All right, speaking of the anthem, it brings up a lot of personalities and a lot of opinions. And that includes LeVar Ball. So LeVar Ball said that players in the NFL, and this is TMZ Sports, by the way, should stand for the national anthem or stay in the locker room or leave the league. So Ball is taking the stance that because the NFL made its rules and it's now etched in legislation, you should follow said rules or simply leave. And a lot of people out there actually have that stance. I've seen a lot of people in the comments section on this very show saying that you work for the NFL and your boss says to either be on the football field standing or be in the locker room and doing with what you please. And as such, you should follow what your employer says. Sometimes I don't think it's that simple because we're not talking about accountants, right? In an office somewhere in the Midwest, we're talking about superstars, people with influence, people who are public figures. So I do think making that parallel is not the best route to go, but I do understand the logic, and that's the logic that LeVar Ball has. And taking this stance actually leads me to believe that he and the president would probably get along again, because you may recall Ball notoriously feuded with President Donald J. Trump about the arrest of LiAngelo back in China. Something does tell me that they probably agree on this topic. So can I just have Donald Trump and LeVar Ball on Twitter again? I really want that. I really do. Hey, are you a fan of LeVar? Let me know in the reaction poll. Give me a heart for you. Enjoy him. Or a leg for LOL no with the period. I put the period there because it adds a little extra emphasis. All right, let's get to the next storyline here. Tom Brady spotted at Gillette Stadium throwing the football with Julian Edelman, but was not present at OTAs. So the dynasty is crumbling, right? All right, so here's the deal. Brady will be at mandatory minicamp this week. If he didn't show up, he's gonna get fined. So he better show up. That's why it is indeed mandatory. So Mike Giardi of NBC Sports Boston reported this story that Brady has been throwing with Julian Edelman in the Gillette Stadium practice bubble on a, quote, semi-regular basis. So for Patriots fans worried that Brady isn't all in, here's a little semblance of commitment, and good commitment at that, because Julian Edelman is coming off a big-time injury, so getting back on the same page with one of the Patriots' star wide receivers, probably a good thing. As I mentioned, Brady skipped voluntary OTAs. Yes, they're voluntary, but still not exactly Brady's MO. If he doesn't show for mandatory minicamp, I can't wait to be back on these airwaves and talking about how there is some very real friction between Tom Brady and Bill Belichick. I already believe that, number one, but if he doesn't show for minicamp, that just feeds into my narrative and the list of evidence points that I've been going through on this show about how there is something brewing between the Patriots leadership and Tom Brady. But he says he's going to be at mandatory minicamp, and I'm sure he'll eventually do a press conference, and I'll tell you what, there will be a lot of questions about the Belichick-Brady relationship. All right, and then the final headline here, this is just kind of comical, but I kind of respect it. Delanie Walker says he's the best tight end in the league. Here's what he said, quote, "Honestly, I feel like I'm the best tight end in the league in all phases." This is a direct quote. I am not taking it out of context. It is right there, plain sight for you guys. So maybe that would be the case, Delaney. Maybe you would have a better argument if Rob Gronkowski retired. And maybe Delaney, for some reason, hasn't been reading the news lately, but Rob Gronkowski is committed to playing in 2018. Look, Walker's a good tight end, definitely top five in the league. I would probably put Gronkowski and Travis Kelce ahead of Delanie Walker in my rankings, just off the top of my head right now. But you certainly can't fault a player for making a statement like that, because it shows confidence. It shows that, you know, they feel good about themselves, but whenever I hear these statements, I do sometimes give the side eye, like, did you actually just say that? Because Eli Manning said that once, and I want to say Joe Flacco said it once as well, and Joe really hasn't performed since that big contract in 2013, and Eli Manning has done what since that Super Bowl back in the 2012 campaign? The 2011 campaign. So there you go. That's the rundown with the latest NFL headlines. Here on the Cam Rogers Show, we are right on time. I love it. I am Cam Rogers. Hit me up on Twitter at MrRogers99. We are presented by AutoList. Are you looking for a new or used car out there? Tired of browsing a million sites? Go to AutoList.com to browse the largest source of inventory on the web. Really great way to look for that new or used car out there. Or download their top-rated mobile app for iPhone or Android today. Be sure to hit me up in comments. New segment here on the program, my top 10 coaching hot seat rankings. Whose seat is getting warm as we enter the 2018 regular season? I'll count you down from 10 to 1. And at number 10 on my list, we will go to the nation's capital. Jay Gruden of the Washington Redskins. So believe it or not, Gruden is the longest tenured coach under the Dan Snyder regime. Also tied for the fifth longest in the 86-year history of the franchise in general. Gruden is signed through the 2020 season after receiving an extension last year, but you really never know with this front office. So the Redskins really didn't help matters in my eyes, bringing in Alex Smith. They didn't hurt matters, but they really didn't help things. I think the best way to put it is kind of a lateral shuffle, if you will, going from Kirk Cousins to Alex Smith. And the Redskins, they need somebody at wide receiver to step up this year to help out Jay Gruden. Whether it's Josh Dotson or Paul Richardson, I really don't care. Jamison Crowder, although he had his chance last year. The Redskins did have a solid draft. I will give them that. Daron Payne, Darius Geis at running back. I actually think the running back core for Washington is shaking out to be pretty good. Their offensive line is okay as well. So you see my hot seat meter. It will get hotter as we go throughout these rankings. Lukewarm for Jay Gruden right now. I wouldn't say this is a make or break season for the Redskins, particularly Jay Gruden, but I think the NFC East can give you some crazy results. And if it's a 4-win, 3-win season for Washington, which I don't expect, but could happen, Jay Gruden could be in trouble. All right, let's go to number 9 on the list. We'll go to Florida, and we've got Adam Gase, head coach of the Miami Dolphins. So, first of all, the Dolphins could be one of the worst teams in the NFL, number one. I'm not saying that will happen. It could. The Dolphins took some major risks letting players go and then adding some questionable ones. Ndamukong Suh no longer there. Jarvis Landry no longer there. They traded for Daniel Kilgore to replace Mike Pouncey at center. Definitely a downgrade. They did sign Josh Sitton. I do like that signing. But Adam Gase's future really depends on how Ryan Tannehill bounces back from injury. Last season was an absolute train wreck with Jay Cutler and Matt Moore at the quarterback position. With Tannehill coming back, first of all, they got to get on the same page as we go throughout the offseason workouts and mandatory minicamp and OTAs, or OTAs already done, but training camp. And then you got the pressure on the wide receivers because Jarvis Landry is no longer there. Kenny Stills or Devontae Parker, one of the two are going to have to step up. I don't know which one will, but they do to save Adam Gase here. So going from 10-6 to 6-10, a playoff team to a punchline, probably not the right trend. So we'll see what happens. Stephen Ross has, you know, notoriously been kind of patient, but Adam Gase had a lot of promise coming in and being the head coach of the Miami Dolphins. And I understand that Tannehill wasn't there last year, but, you know, sometimes there's not a lot of forgiveness for NFL coaches out there. We'll say good draft, Minkah Fitzpatrick, Mike Gesicki, Jerome Baker, good players. We'll see how they do. All right, let's go to number 8. We got Mike McCarthy, head coach of the Green Bay Packers. And it seems like McCarthy has been on and off the hot seat for the past 7 seasons, really. And the Packers are shaking things up again with new DC Mike Pettine and Joe Philbin as the offensive coordinator reuniting with the Green Bay Packers. He was previously an assistant. And the Packers are coming off a year where they missed the postseason for the first time since 2008. And of course, you can point to the Aaron Rodgers injury as the main reason why. But McCarthy has been around long enough to at least show some sort of fight, even when you lose a top two quarterback, perhaps the best quarterback in the NFL right now, and the Packers had no fight. I remember watching the Ravens game when Baltimore traveled up to Lambeau, and the Ravens absolutely wiped the floor of the Packers. And so let's say, God forbid, another injury happens to Aaron Rodgers and the Green Bay Packers just lay down, then, you know, Mike McCarthy could be on the chopping block. So we'll see what happens there. Let's go to number 7 on the list. Todd Bowles, head coach of the Jets. So the Jets have been quite patient with Bowles as he endures this kind of rebuilding process. And I have the hot seat meter at toasty for now. He did sign a 2-year contract extension last December, which on the surface could indicate that the team is invested in him. As of now, Christopher Johnson wants to see how this whole Todd Bowles and GM Mike Magagnon duo could work out in New York. And the main storyline here is, of course, the quarterback position. Who wins the competition among Josh McCown, Teddy Bridgewater, and Sam Darnold, their number one or their number or first round pick, I should say. And so you got McCown, who's the incumbent, clearly understands he's not the long-term solution, and also is willing to kind of play a mentor role. You've got Teddy Bridgewater, who's more stuck in this purgatory type of role here, where his ceiling is like, for the Jets, being a starter at the quarterback position or being traded. Like, that would be the floor. So there's that, and then there's Sam Darnold, who's raw but has a good upside. I do like the offensive coordinator, Jeremy Bates. I have a lot of faith in him to help out that offense. I think the defense has some nice pieces. Leonard Williams had a really good season in 2017. They got a couple of young secondary players, first-round selection, second-round selection from 2017, respectively. So the Jets can take a step forward in 2018. The question is, how much patience will Christopher Johnson have? And we'll see what happens. Sounds like there's a fairly good amount for now. All right, let's go to number 6 on the list, and John Elway is staying patient with this guy, Vance Joseph, but that could change if the Broncos have another 5-11 campaign. Why is that? Well, John Elway was pretty forgiving with Vance Joseph last year because Trevor Siemian played quarterback, as did Brock Osweiler and all these other misfits at the position. So there was some forgiveness there. Now you have Case Keenum at the quarterback position, a guy who is capable, at least dating back to 2017, at playing the quarterback position. So if Case Keenum is there and you get another 5-11 campaign with a talented defense that now has, of course, Bradley Chubb on that front 7, Vance Joseph could be in trouble. And you're also talking about an offense that isn't elite by anything, by any imagination, but I mean, you've got Royce Freeman, who I like a lot, especially from a fantasy football perspective. Couple of solid receivers in Demaryius Thomas and Emmanuel Sanders. Good news that they kept them. So the offense is looking okay. The defense is one of the best in the league, top 10, obviously. And I think the AFC West will no doubt be a dogfight. I can't really decide who's the favorite. I did say earlier that the Chargers on paper should win the division, but you know what they say about being on paper, so there you go. Vance Joseph at number 6. Let's go to number 5, John Harbaugh of my Baltimore Ravens. So the Ravens have made the playoffs just once the last 5 years. Of course, back in 2014 when they took down Ben Roethlisberger and the Steelers at the big ketchup bottle and then should have beat the Patriots and probably should have went to the Super Bowl, but I digress. Eventually, a head coaching situation can grow stale. And for John Harbaugh, it could be the end if the Ravens absolutely lay down in 2018. Why? Well, GM Ozzie Newsome moving on as well. So why not fire John Harbaugh too and start fresh? So the Ravens have taken steps to improve the offense. Michael Crabtree, John Brown, Willie Snead, Hayden Hurst, first round of the draft. I don't know why. Mark Andrews as well. Offensive line is shifting, but should be pretty good, actually. I'm hearing good stuff out of OTAs about that front 5. So I don't think John Harbaugh is going to get fired, but if the Ravens aren't very good in 2018, something to monitor. Harbaugh's at 5. Let's go to number 4. His name is Jason Garrett. Jerry Jones reiterated back in January that Garrett is not on the hot seat, but let's be real, if the Cowboys missed the playoffs in 2018, I think Garrett could be in trouble. And the Cowboys missed the playoffs last year for the 5th time in 7 years. Garrett was named the NFL's Coach of the Year after that 13-3 finish back in 2016. And can you believe we're talking about perhaps a hot seat now for this guy? I will say, 9-7 record last year, without Zeke for a few games, and injuries to Tyron Smith and Sean Lee, really not all that bad. And I'm kind of annoyed when people are saying we're overrating the Dallas Cowboys. Did you hear what I just said? They went 9-7 without the services of an elite linebacker at times, an elite left tackle, and a stud running back. And now they're all coming back and presumably healthy. Why not think the Dallas Cowboys could make the playoffs? So Garrett faced a lot of pressure, you may recall, entering that 2014 campaign, right? After a string of 8-8 seasons, and then that pressure turned into a good year where DeMarco Murray balled out, Tony Romo was good, they made the playoffs. So maybe he can channel that 2014 form. All right, let's go to number 3 here. We've got Dirk Cutter of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Cut it out. I can already imagine the headlines when this guy is fired. So the good news is Cutter is already a longer tenured coach than the last two Buccaneers head coaches. He will tie the 3 seasons of Raheem Morris for the most of any head coach in the post-John Gruden era. So how about that? There you go, Dirk. Good for you, buddy. So the NFC South is absolutely brutal in that it's difficult from that perspective. And the Bucs could be facing, honestly, guys, 6 losses right off the bat. They could be swept by the Falcons, Panthers, and Saints, because that's how good those 3 teams are. The Buccaneers are talented, but I think patience could be wearing thin on Dirk Cutter. I am not a fan of this guy as a head coach, and one of the main reasons why I have him here, and I have him in my boiling hot category, he's not getting along with Jameis Winston. Who do you think the Buccaneers are going to side with, their franchise quarterback or this guy? Let's be real. Cutter's at number 3. Let's go to number 2 on the list. Speaking of people who I have no idea why are still employed as a head coach, Marvin Lewis of the Cincinnati Bengals. I truly want to know why he is still there. He is the 2nd longest tenured coach in the NFL and has made the playoffs 7 times in 15 seasons. And he has 0 wins to show for it. So the Bengals also, will say, showed a willingness to spend this offseason bringing in Preston Brown. Good linebacker coming on over from Buffalo. Also, good tackle, Cordy Glenn, coming over from the Bills. But it's not like these two players are totally going to revamp the Cincinnati Bengals. I think there's a very real chance this team finishes dead last in the AFC North. Yes, behind the Cleveland Browns. So Marvin Lewis is at number 2. But honestly, there could be just the fact that Marvin will always be a head coach. Like, he will be 95 and still the head coach of the Cincinnati Bengals, and the Bengals will still be without a playoff win with this guy. So, honestly, that's what we're staring at. With that, let's get to number 1 here, and his name is Hugh Jackson. Obviously, right? GM John Dorsey has done everything in his power to piece together a winning team, at least a competitive team. Tyrod Taylor, Baker Mayfield at quarterback, Carlos Hyde, you got Jarvis Landry, Josh Gordon, EJ Gaines in that secondary, who I like a lot. If Hugh Jackson is short of 7 wins this season, I think he's in major trouble because I don't think Dorsey or the front office in general will be as forgiving. I actually think the Browns could win 7-8 games this year just because of the talent they have on that team. Now, it all has to come together. It all has to mesh, and I understand that. And sometimes these players don't mesh when you have a lot of free agency additions and trades and all that stuff. But we're talking about a coach who's just 1-31 in his Browns coaching career. And the dog pound is ready for results. They want them in 2018. Baker Mayfield coming to town at the number 1 overall selection. He brings a lot of energy, of course, coming on over, winning the Heisman with the Sooners. So Hugh Jackson checks in at number 1. Let's summarize the list. Here you go. 5 up to 1 here. You got Hugh Jackson, you got Marvin Lewis, you got Dirk Cutter, Jason Garrett, John Harbaugh. Those are the 5 candidates that could be in some serious trouble if their seasons don't go to plan. Vance Joseph at 6, Todd Bowles at 7, Mike McCarthy at 8, Adam Gase at number 9, and then Jay Gruden there at number 10. Whose seat is the hottest? Let me know in this reaction poll. Jason Garrett, Hugh Jackson, Marvin Lewis perhaps, Dirk Cutter. Give me a like, laughing face, heart, or wow face, respectively. I'll be tracking what you guys react with, and of course, what you guys say in the comments section, as always. You have been watching The Cam Rogers Show. I am Cam Rogers. I will see you back here Wednesday morning, 10 o'clock Eastern time. If you miss any of the video, keep it right here, because we're looping it for you. See you Wednesday.